22nd chapter. Then the Pharisees went and plotted to entrap him in what he said. So they sent their disciples to him, along with the Herodians, saying, "Teacher, we know that you are sincere and teach the way of God in accordance with the truth, and show deference to no one, for you do not regard people with partiality. Tell us then what you think. Is it lawful to pay taxes to the emperor or not?" But Jesus, aware of their malice, said, "Why are you putting me to the test, you hypocrites? Show me a coin used for the tax." And they brought him a denarius. And then he said to them, "Whose head is this, and whose title?" They answered, "The emperor's." Then he said to them, "Give, therefore, to the emperor the things that are the emperor's, and to God the things that are God's." When they heard this, they were amazed, and they left him and went away. The Gospel of the Lord. Martin Luther wrote an explanation to many things in the Catechism, such as the Ten Commandments, the Apostles' Creed, and the Lord's Prayer, and Holy Communion and baptism. So the small catechism is all these documents of our faith that are so important to us, with some explanations given. And he also, of course, did that for the Lord's Prayer. And we say, "Our Father." Well, Luther said, "Well, what does that mean?" That means God wants us to approach him as children with a father. And we come to God, our Father, who art in heaven. And it talks about God in heaven, and hallowed be thy name. What does it mean for God to be holy and just? So the explanations go on like that, phrase by phrase, petition by petition. And when we pray, "Give us this day our daily bread," Luther says that we are asking for more than just bread or food. He suggests that it refers to everything included in the necessities and nourishment of our bodies, such as food, drink, clothing, shoes, house, farm, fields, livestock, money, property, and then it goes on yet, not finished yet. An upright spouse, upright children, upright members of the household, upright and faithful rulers, good government, good weather, peace, health, decency, honor, good friends, faithful neighbors, and the like. That's quite a list. It's a lot of things to encompass in just that one petition when we pray for our daily bread. That's how Luther wants us to think about our prayer to God. Provide for us all the good things in life that will sustain us in our daily life. Some of you remember that a couple years ago I presented a song about the Apostles' Creed that I had written that incorporated the Apostles' Creed and the meanings that are in the small catechism. And you'll remember, if you do it, a little bit lengthy, because there's a little bit of detail there as well. Well, I'm here to tell you that I put this to music at one point, and if you're brave enough to ask me what to present it or perform it sometime, I warn you, it's longer than the creed. And by a lot, maybe a couple times longer. I wrote it as a tool to remember, for memorizing long texts. And I performed it once for a music teacher of mine who's teaching me about writing music, and he didn't think it would catch on anytime soon. He said he tried to get into it, but he kind of lost me at good government. I had to agree with him that any song that has the words "good government" in it is going to be bogged down. So I let the song go, and I will spare you that performance. Well, as I was reading this scripture for today about the question of paying taxes, This song came to mind. I was reminded of my teacher's comments about the words good government. It struck me that we just wouldn't think to pray for a good government or think about it much. Maybe we take for granted a good government. What is a good government? How can we pray for it and how can that happen? But it is something very important. It's something we have invested a lot in, and we should invest a lot in. We all pay taxes. We all serve and help in whatever way we can, by following the laws and by respecting authority. And surely it's not a bad thing to pray for a good government. It's something we might need to do from time to time. But we don't always think of government as good or bad. We just think of it as it's a neutral thing. It's kind of like the highway system or whatever, but it's just there. And we think maybe people are good or bad, but we don't think the government is one way or the other. It's just an inanimate, positive or not positive or negative structure. But really, when you think about it, it couldn't be further from the truth. If we were to compare the governments of the past or some governments from around the world that exist and compare them to what we have today, we would quickly see that there are differences in the systems of government. And there are very bad governments and some better ones. And we might look at ours and think it's pretty good, actually, and maybe not perfect and maybe not best possible, but certainly the best yet. And so we might get used to it, but perhaps we should not take it for granted. We are blessed. We're extremely blessed to have a system that functions as well as it does. And there's so much that goes unnoticed. Now, when the Pharisees asked Jesus about paying taxes to the government, it was with the understanding that they had a very bad government. There's no question that everything about it was wrong. They were under the thumb of an emperor who was violent, whose system was based on individuals that could wield a lot of power and a lot of sway in their decisions. They could do whatever they wanted within certain limits, but they forced people to live under some degree of fear. And they also had the idea that they could force people to honor the emperor as a god. Now, the people of Israel, the Jewish people there, would rather have had their own king, even if their own king was not very good, a tyrant perhaps, but they would not have had to submit to the indignity of an emperor from Rome. That was a humiliation to them. Now, if we had lived under that government, we too might have wondered, should we pay taxes to this government? I think we might have even considered saying no or rebelling. And there were many people in that day agitating for a revolt against Rome. It was a bad system, full of corruption and suffering. So it made for an easy question, a way to test Jesus, to trap him. What could Jesus say, after all, for this question? Could he say yes or no to this question and get away with it? Because if Jesus wanted a good image with the people and with the population that was angry at the government, he'd have to say, no, we shouldn't pay taxes, because then that's what they would want to hear. But if he said that, then they could accuse him of being a rebel or having guilty of sedition. So they could catch him either way. But if he said, yes, we should pay taxes, then it would embarrass him in front of the people who were angry at Rome. And so it was a no-win answer, a question that he had to answer. So how Jesus worked out of this snare is a sign of his wisdom and his sensitivity to the Spirit's guidance. Jesus found a profound answer in his understanding that God has placed rulers over us for our good, even if they are not good people. It's perhaps better to have a bad king than no king. Whatever Jesus meant, in this case, he did not lean towards revolution or disobedience. What he meant was pay taxes, but what he also did not say that there would never come a time when you would disobey or go against your government. The real question is, where does our ultimate allegiance lie? Is it to Rome or to ourselves, or is it to God? You see, every ruler in this world, whether good or bad, may be worth supporting in most situations. No ruler, however, is deserving of our soul. Only God should be honored with our full commitment. We cannot go against conscience when we are given the choice of whether to follow God or man. We must always choose God. But that doesn't mean we don't have an obligation to obey our rulers and government in most situations. We are obligated to do all that we can to support our government and help it be a good organ of society. We ought to pay our dues, whether it is in the form of taxes or service. We ought to honor its laws as much as possible and live in accordance with its values and its foundations. So in most cases, this will not conflict with our ultimate loyalty to God. God has given us, I believe, a good government. We have a gift. And we pray that God will help us continue to have a good government. And let's commit ourselves to make this government as good as it can be, to make the world better. After all, Jesus died for the world to bless the world, bless us. He called us to be agents of good and light and salt and peace and grace in the world. We are given a task to share the love of Christ to everyone we meet. We are given a task to support peace and support the country that in many ways is the greatest blessing in the world today. So in that sense, it's good to pray for our country, to bless our country, and to honor and to pray for a good government. And I hope we will all do our civic responsibility by voting, by paying our taxes, by serving our country. And yet we will always have our ultimate loyalty to God and our desire to give our lives completely to whatever God calls us to do. But we thank God for what we have, and we continue to pray that he will bless our land and prosper and help us in every way, both for our own sake, but also for the sake of others. So let's pray for that today. Heavenly Father, as we ponder this question of our place in this world, our responsibility to the authorities and power structures of our world, we pray that we would give support what we can according to your will, and help us to look to you always to be our ultimate guide in every decision. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Christ our Lord, to you. sun and moon and stars of light. Christ our Lord, to you we raise this our sacrifice of praise. For the joy of ear and eye, for the heart and mind's delight, for the mystic harmony linking sense to sound and sight. Christ our Lord, to you we raise this our sacrifice of praise. For the joy of human love, brother, sister, parent, child, friends on earth and friends above, for all gentle thoughts and mild. Christ our Lord, to you we raise this our sacrifice of praise. For yourself, best gift divine, to the world so freely give, agent of God's grand design, peace on earth and joy in heaven. Christ our Lord, to you we raise this our sacrifice of praise. Thank you.